हेलो फ्रेंड्स, वेलकम टू अवर यूट्यूब चैनल। होप यू एंजॉयड माय लास्ट वीडियोस। इन माय लास्ट वीडियोस आई कवर्ड द क्रिप्टो प्रोफाइल एंड SSL इन द डेटा पावर। आई टुक फ्यू यूज केसेस एंड आई एक्सप्लेन्ड एज पर द यूज केसेस हाउ वी कैन क्रिएट डिफरेंट काइंड ऑफ प्रोफाइल्स, क्रिप्टो प्रोफाइल्स इन द डेटा पावर। सो नाउ आई एम गोइंग टू मूव अवर नेक्स्ट ट्यूटोरियल। Actually, I received some feedback and comments from the viewers. They were asking me to make some videos on the web service proxy and the multi-protocol gateway. From last few videos, I was covering the admin part, but as I got some comments, so I am preparing some videos for web service proxy and the multi-protocol gateway. But don't worry, guys. During our development part, I'll try to cover the admin part as well, and if it would be needed, I'll create some new separate videos for the admin part. So don't worry, keep watching our videos, both as a development part and the admin part. I'll try to cover the admin part during the development videos. So today I'll cover how we'll create the web service proxy. It would be very simple one. Just simple, we'll write a welcome message, we'll write a simple XSLT. So how we can use the XSLT into our web service proxy, and I'll try to cover few topics which will be very helpful during the web service proxy. So first let's go step by step. First I want to tell you what is web service proxy. As the name suggests, web service proxy, means if you want to proxy your web service. Means for example, you have your web service, okay, and it's your it is available in your application zone, and you want to expose that web service to the outer world. So to provide the security and some other features, you want to proxy that service via the data power. So for that we are using here web service proxy. Mainly you can proxy a web service in the data power by web service proxy and the multi-protocol gateway. So we'll learn step by step. So first here we'll learn web service proxy. In the web service proxy, the main part of web service proxy is it's a WSDL based, WSDL based. And as it's a WSDL based, so here you can use a SOAP based message only. So in web service proxy, you can use a WSDL that would be the SOAP based. So web service proxy here mainly defined for the message which is SOAP based. You can't use here JSON message and other kinds of format. So for this you need only the SOAP message only. And the other part is if you want to define multiple rules, that would be at the level of like proxy level. If you want to define some rules, or you want to define some rule as the WSDL level, or if you want to define the rule as the service level, or if you want to define the rule the port level, means as per your use cases you can define the rules as per your requirement. Okay, I'll show you how we'll do this thing during that session. And other part is like if you want other part, as I mentioned in my previous videos, that if you want to proxy any web service, you would require some front side handler. So here in the web service proxy, you can use multiple kind of front side handler. The same front side handler is available in your multi protocol gateway as well. And other part is like here we'll as I showed you that in the policy level we can create the multiple rules or operation. I'll show you how we'll create. Another part is like proxy setting. In the proxy setting, I also showed in my last videos, if you want to communicate with the destination server, then we can define some profile SSL configuration here. So we'll define the SSL configuration here. And you can do, if there is some, if you want to implement some different kind of threat protection, like XML threat protection, or if you want to implement some SQL injection. So same protection is available in your multi-protocol gateway as well. I'll show you that in the session of multi-protocol gateway. So here, if you want to use XML threat protection, or if you want to use XDOS, XML denial of services. So with the use cases, I'll try to cover all these topics, like if you want to stop, or if you want to secure our system with the SQL SQL injection. So for that, we can use this SQL injection. I'll show you in my further videos, I'll show you how we can use this. So as part of web service proxy, the main thing is, in the web service proxy we'll use SOAP based messages, and as it's a SOAP based, so here prerequisite is WSDL file. So while creating any web service, we would need a WSDL file, okay? And after having the WSDL file, we'll import that WSDL file. But if you have multi-protocol gateway, in that you don't need the WSDL file, you can simply proxy your web service web service. Okay, so when I'll make a video for the multi-protocol gateway, I'll show you how we can use the SOAP service, SOAP service, and REST-based services. I'll demonstrate all those things. So here, we'll start how we can create a web service proxy, and how we can write a very simple XSLT. That simply it will write a welcome message into your logs. Okay, so how we'll create a web service proxy. So first, here in the services tab, we'll go to web service proxy. Okay. So here we'll add we'll create one web service proxy. So here is I have a WSDL file that is basically for currency converter. I downloaded it from the internet. You can download it's freely available, so you can download from there. If it would be needed, you can send me email. I'll share the WSDL file with you. So after that, we'll create one. So here we need a WSDL file, and the main thing is, when you'll upload the WSDL file, and it referring some XSD file. And if the WSDL file is corrupted, it will not upload here successfully. It may upload, but here in the drop down, you'll not able to see the WSDL file. We face this issue many times, because when we uploaded the WSDL file, it shows it's uploaded, but in the drop down, we were unable to see the WSDL file. So many times WSDL file have schema validation file, that is XSD. So they are referring to those XSD. And one XSD may referring to another XSD. So you just make sure prior to upload any WSDL file, if there is some reference file, so all the files shall be in one place. Or sometime it may work, if you'll make a GIF file, if you'll keep all the WSDL file and XSD file in one GIF file, into one GIF folder, sometime it will work, sometime it may work. So you need to correct the references, so that when we'll upload the WSDL file, all the files shall be available during the upload. Okay, so I'll upload, though I have the file, but I'll show you one how we can upload. Okay, I have this currency WSDL file. Okay, I'll make it lab. You can rename the file, no problem. Currency converter. Okay, upload. Okay, as of now, the files will be uploaded into our local folder. But see, now we can see that the file, we can see the file is available here, means our visual file is correct. Okay, now we can see that our visual file is uploaded successfully. As I told you, we shall have a front side handler on which our services will be available. So here we'll create one HTTP handler. As we can see here that there are multiple kind of front side handler like FTP, NFS, IMS, IBM, MQ, SFTP, HTTP and HTTPS. Okay, so as per our requirement, we can choose the front side handler. Just for here lab session, we are using HTTP front side handler. In my previous video, I have already shown you how we can use HTTPS handler as well. Okay, so by default is 80, so we'll change it. So we'll mention a name FSH currency. Okay, and here IP would be a default IP, so here we'll use. Okay, and as I told already that the by default the get method is disabled, and if it disabled and while you will try to create a project in in the SOAP UI, it will not work, and you will not able to download the visual file, because to download the visual file your get method shall be enabled. So here, okay, like here if you need any like head operations options or trace delete method, so as per your requirement you can enable those operations as well. As of now, as per our requirement, we are just enable the get method only. Okay, as it is HTTP front side handler, so here we don't need to upload our certificate, as it is HTTP only. Okay, so for this we need to just mention the port, and we need to mention the method type. We enable the method type as get operation. Okay, and we shall mention it's HTTP currency. Okay, and sometime it will happen if you don't remember what all operate. See, we found that the cannot install without a service. That is fine, we'll create that service. Sometime you'll find that the port is not available, means if the same port is used by the another web service, then the same port you cannot use. I'll show you how we can use the same front side handler. Like for example, you get two services, okay, or three services or multiple services, and you want to use a common HTTP handler for all those services, then in my further video I'll let you know how we can create only one front side handler that will work for multiple web services. Okay, so for this we are using this one. So here it took the URI from the WSDL file. Okay, so but we can customize URI. Okay, so like here we are using lab currency. Fine, it is fine, and we are adding this one. Okay, so here this is HTTP get. If you want to create HTTP 1.0 or 1.2, you can create a multiple endpoint handler, multiple front end handler. Okay, so here you can select here. This is for SOAP 1.2, and this is for here like a SOAP 1.1. You can see here this is for SOAP 1.2. Okay, so this part is done. Now we will move to next step. Here we'll click on next step. Okay, some error it shows. Okay, no problem. So here we need to add the handlers. Fine, now we'll click on next. Fine, now we can see that all the three front end handler is up and this part is done, means our visual file is uploaded successfully, and all three actually we created one front end handler, but it requires three handlers for HTTP, so 1.1 and 1.2. The visual is like that only, but for many services you will find only you would require to and you would need to create only one type of handler. So it depends upon the kind of visual. So for this visual we need to create three. Okay, here in the policy there are multiple tabs available here. If you want to get some SLM policy here, then you can use and define those policies here. In our next videos I will cover like how we can get SLM policies, and in the policy we'll create the rules. We'll create a simple message, for that we'll use that policy tab. For example, if you want to create some profile for the destination system, so here you can define some SL profile here. That already we covered in our last video. Okay, and if you want to add some headers, if you want to inject some header, if you want to add some header parameter, you can add here. And if you want to express some headers, you can mention the headers name here. And if you want to monitor some messages and message counter, message count monitors, and if you want to monitor the duration, so you can mention here. And as I mentioned that if you want to implement the XML thread protection, so you can do the settings here. But for this we will move to policy tab. We'll create a simple policy for welcome message. So as I mentioned that we can define the rules or policies at the proxy level, at the visual level, service level, and the port level. If we'll make any change here, like I'll show you one thing, like if here if you want to if you want to enable and disable some settings here, we can do. Like if you want to enable if you want to validate the request message or response message, okay, by default alls are enabled. Okay, if you want to enable and disable like request message for some time for testing purposes, if you don't have the exact request message, so we'll disable this one. And if you don't have the schema validation, or if you don't want to validate the response message which we'll receive from the destination system, for that we can disable this one. Or if you have some mTOM policies, okay, and if you don't want to accept that your message will accept the mTOM, so you can enable and disable these settings accordingly. So as per your use cases, you can enable and disable these settings. Okay, so for this I am disabling the validate request message and the validate response messages. Okay, so I am done. If I made change here, all the changes will be available to the in the hierarchy, down hierarchy. So we can see here it's the changes are shown here. So for this what we'll do, I'll create a simple policy, a simple processing rule for that. So for that I'll go to proxy. In the proxy we can see visual, and in the visual we can see the services. In the services we'll create the processing rules. Fine. So here we need to mention the rule name, and here we need to there are four kind of direction. You can create a rule that will be applicable for source to destination and vice versa, or you can create a rule that would be from server to the client. For example, when we are data power is connecting to a backend system, in that case if we are getting a response from the backend system, then the rule direction would be server to client. And when and the direction client to server means when data power is connecting to the destination system, in that case the rule direction would be client to server. And the last one is error, means whenever data power is connecting to the backend system and some error occurs, or when backend system is sending any response message to the data power and at that time some failure or some error occurring, for that we'll create a error rules. For this video I'll note is the web error rules, but in the further video I'll show you how we can use the error rules, means how we can capture the different kind of events code and how we can customize an error message as per the events code. Okay, I'll show you in my next video. Okay, but now here I'm creating a simple route from client to server, and then I'll create a simple rule from server to client. Okay, so here we need to mention the rule name. So here automatically it will pick, here you can see the lab currency converter, that is the name of our web service proxy. Okay, and here the rule 2, so we can just mention here, this is for our request, so just mention the name of the rule as request, lab currency converter request. Okay, so here automatically a match rule will be created, but in multi protocol gateway you need to create a match rule. Okay, but web service proxy provide you the facility that you can automatically the match rule will be created for that policy. Okay, so as we can see that here this the match rule is created, and if you want to customize this match rule, you can create a match rule when we'll use the multi protocol gateway. I'll show you how we'll customize a match rule or how we'll create the match rule for that. Okay, all these objects, okay, is available in your multi protocol gateway as well. Okay, if you want to filter if you want to use filter object, you can use the filter object. If you want to sign and verify your request message at that time, you can use these objects, or if you want to encrypt or decrypt your message, you can use these messages. If you want to use SSLT, then you can use this transform tab, or if you want to route your message to destination system, you can use route. And if you want to write some gateway script, you can use this object. And to authorize authentication to your request messages, then you can use this action. And if you want to use some SLM policy or some advanced feature, you can use. We'll use use cases for all these actions object, and I'll show you how we can use all these object as per the use cases. For this use case, we'll use a simple transform action. And guys, I'll suggest you please go through the W3 schools, learn their basic SSLT, or you can go to any website from where you can learn the basic of SSLT, means how you can traverse a message from root to a specific element, or if you want to get a value of a specific element. So just learn some basic concept of SSLT, it would be very helpful during your development. So here I am using SSLT. Okay, and in the SSLT there are some important part like the input. By default it will pick the auto, means auto means by default whatever message we are receiving, it would be input type would be auto. Or if we want that we want to mention that input would be input. Okay, so here we'll mention the input. Okay, and in the output by default is output. Okay, but I'll show you, let me upload a visual file, then some more option will be available here. Okay, so here we need to upload SSLT file. So let me upload SSLT file. Okay, I have this welcome SSLT file. Okay, so upload this one. Okay, the file is already available, so what we'll do, we'll overwrite here. Okay, and here we'll mention the currency welcome. Okay, now we don't need to overwrite the existing file. So now this is the file is uploaded successfully. Okay, so still here is output. Okay, output, no, we want to use it as a pipe. Okay, no problem, I'll show you how it will change when we'll use a result action. Okay, so now here automatically the change is pipe. Okay, see here pipe. So in the output null, one is auto whatever is the output would be the null means let I have one more SSLT here. Okay, and here maybe we'll find some more options. See here, as we have one more SSLT before that, so now we need to define that input would be the input message which is received in this rule, or if the input would be pipe means the output of the first SSLT would be the input of this SSLT. Okay, so don't confuse between the input and the pipe. Input means means you have multiple SSLT in your rules, like here you have two SSLTs. Okay, and first access, or here you can use the input also. Okay, input means whatever message is comes to that rules will be the input of that SSLT. Oh, and if the input is the pipe means the output of the first SSLT, means the SSLT which is before that SSLT will be the input of this SSLT. Okay, and here output is null. Null means this, the output of this action or this rule will not impact to other SSLT, or it would not be the input of the other SSLT. Okay, output means it would be the output, means this is output means whatever the output or the result of this SSLT will be the final output, and the output will be sent to the destination system. Or if you want to create any variable like client underscore message, okay, so you can use this one also. And if in any of the SSLT which is lying in the same rule, if they'll use their input as client underscore message, then the output of this SSLT will be the input of that SSLT. Okay, so as of now we have only one SSLT, but in your case you may have multiple SSLT, and as per your use cases you have to decide that the output of this SSLT would be input of the next SSLT, or the output of this SSLT will not impact or not useful for any SSLT. So in that case you need to have your output as the null. Or if you want the output of this SSLT would be the input of the next SSLT, then your output would be the pipe. Okay, so depends upon your use cases. You have to, in my next video when I'll take the multiple use cases, then I'll show you in which case we need to change our input and the output. Okay, so we are using only one SSLT, so we don't use of this, so we can delete this one. So here our input would be the input because we are capturing the message, and here output would be the pipe. Okay, and if you'll see in the result action is the last action of your rules. So here you can see that your input would be the pipe and output would be the output, because this is your last action of your rules. Okay, done. Now we'll create one more rules. Okay, that would be for your, as of now I'll not use any access, sorry, yes, for this we'll use this one, and here we need to mention the response. Okay, and here we need to mention the, okay, here we are not doing anything, we are just result action we are using. Okay, and I'll show you what we have. Let me save this one first. Okay, and I'll show you what we have in our welcome SSLT. So okay, and we'll save this one. Okay, I'll show you what we have in our simple XSLT file. Okay, you can see the content from here, or you can go to your file directory and in the local you'll find that file and you can see that one. Okay, so here we'll view this one. Okay, and we'll copy the content. Okay, and we'll use. Okay, so this is the content of the file. Okay, here we need to mention some prefix that like for data part we are using this extension. Okay, if you want to use some date, then we need to use these prefixes. As of now we are not using DPs, but in the further I'll show you how we can use the date function. So for that I'm just using that generic some namespace, and after that I'm not using this one else. As of now we are not using this one, but later I'll show you what is the use of this one. So for the time being you can ignore this part. Okay, so here we are mentioning the output. We are omitting the XML declaration. Yes. Okay, now our main part will start from here. We will traverse the message from the root. Okay, from the beginning we'll traverse the message, and what we are doing, first we are copying a message, whatever as in the rule we mentioned the input is our input message. Okay, so what we are creating here, a variable. The way of creating variable, like we XSL variable, and here we'll mention the name of the variable. Okay, and what it will do, it will copy the complete message. Copy of select star means it will copy the complete message. Okay, actually as we need to forward that message to our backend system, for that we are copying. And in the next video when we'll log the message, at the time we would need this variable to log the message into our in our system logs, or if you want to log our message into any file, then I'll show you how we'll use this variable. And here is the part when we want to write a message into our logs. Okay, in our system logs, then we need to mention we will use XSL message, and here we need to mention the priority is error, because in our log target I have set the priority as error. Okay, so I'll show you how it will be visible at there. So here we are just mentioning welcome my first web service proxy currency converter, and here I'm closing this XSL message. And as I mentioned in my policy that this message output would be pipe. Okay, as the result is our last action and it would be the input of that message. So whatever message we are receiving would be the output of this XSLT, and it will go to the destination system. Okay, so I'll use this one and fine. Now I'll show you how we'll test from the SOAP UI. Okay, so we'll go to our SOAP UI. Okay, I'll create a new SOAP project. Okay, project name is lab. Port is 5050, and let me check what is the name of our web service proxy. Here we can see the name is our lab currency. Okay, okay, and we need to mention WSTLs. So that as I showed you that our get method shall be enabled, otherwise we will not able to download the WSDL file. Some issue. Let's check what is the issue. We need to mention the same name here. Okay, and we'll make the same changes here as well. Okay. Okay, now it's all the changes done. Now we will save it. Okay, we'll try, and it's work fine. So this is the file, so we'll use a simple operation here. I don't know the exact value and I don't have the credential for that, but just for simple testing, like from USD. Okay, I don't have the credential to test this service, but just for simple testing I'm using this one, from USD to INR. Okay, and amount is like 400 rupees. Okay, so let's trigger the request. Okay, see, so it's failed some registration error we can see here, and but we are confirmed that we received this response from the backend system. Okay, as we don't have the credential and all the values of this parameter, so that's why we are getting this response message. But the good thing is that we are able to connect with the destination system and we got some response. Okay, and we'll see in the error in the system log, we'll see what is captured there. Okay, so here, as I showed you, that the low target is error, category is errors, and here we can see that welcome my first web service proxy currency converter. Okay, and so guys, as I told you, please go through some basic idea of XSLT, because in my next videos I'll show you how we can use the service variables. Prior to that, I'll let you know what kind of variables available into our data power, because that is very important for the development perspective. And I'll show you what are the different event codes are available, and if you want to do the logging, the customized logging. Okay, so how we can use the service variable for that, how we can extract the value from the service variable, and how we'll use those variable for the logging and for other customization of the web service proxy. So guys, just keep watching this video and try to learn. As I am repeating again, try to learn XSLT as much you can, because that will help you during our development perspective. So for today, for this video, only the for this video, this is for welcome message only. I'll explore more part in my further videos. So for the time being, keep watching our videos. I have already created some 10-15 videos, so keep watching all the videos, and keep doing exercise, stay healthy. Thank you guys, thank you friends.